Hello, everybody. My name is Eric D. Johnson, also known as Bryce Hunt. I live here in the city of Memphis, which is in the state of Tennessee, and is in the county of Shelby. And today and date is early Monday morning, August the 17th, 2015. Excuse me. Time, 2:30 a.m. And I always say thank you to my fans, my supporters, for your continued encouragement and your support. And I'll continue to keep my chef employed right here in this area. And right now in South Haven, Mississippi, at this padded place, padded management service. I'll continue to further my education at Monroe College online. And I'm pursuing my associate's degree. I'm studying business administration, concentration in marketing. And we're gonna get right into today's video. We're gonna continue to talk about African traditional religion. And because we don't never stop talking about African traditional religion. And today and day, you know, occurring events. You know, some came up in the news that which is in relation to what we was talking about last week about not only Black Lives Matter, all lives matter, that slowest situation, but I think that was last weekend. Yeah, that was last weekend. In previous videos, we've been talking about the demographics, and we're gonna continue talking about demographics because it's very important when we discuss, you know, today's current events. Because as we know, based on history, when we look around the world, when we look at countries and nations, have been influenced by colonialism. We know that colonialism has been one of the biggest influences on this planet, and still today you see the remnants of colonialism. When you look at the borders, not just on the continent of Africa, you can look all around the world. Colonialism, when you look right here in the Western Hemisphere, colonialism from North, Central, South America, the Caribbean Islands, colonialism. All the Pacific Islands, colonialism. New Zealand, Australia, colonialism. India, colonialism. Bangladesh, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Iran, Iraq, Sri Lanka, you name every country on this planet has been affected by colonialism. You go to East Asia, Japan, was it Marco Polo? If I'm not mistaken. If I am mistaken, but you know who I'm talking about. A European went over to Japan. You know, such colonialism. Korea. China. That's why you have a Hong Kong today. Why you have a Taiwan today. Colonialism. When you see the Philippines, Indonesia. When you see Malaysia, every country on this planet has been affected by European colonialism. And when we talk about African traditional religion, we know that the continent of Africa has been definitely impacted by colonialism. We see the borders. We see the border, and we see a new border today. South Sudan, they draw the line. Sudan, the country was already drawn out on the map. So the South Sudan came about because the people in the South Sudan in the area made an agreement. You had North Sudan, now you have South Sudan. And that's where that line, they draw that line. And that's what we want to talk about today. And we're going to continue to talk about how serious it is that there's a South Sudan today. And that North Sudan is there always, and it's been there. And then in Khartoum, the capital, is in the north. Now we know that the North Sudanese are Afro-Asiatic Arabs. And we know they have embassies in places around the world. And we know they're diplomats. This is a very serious issue when it comes to influence. See, this is something that you never negate. You never negate the impact or the influence of these diplomats, the Afro-Asiatic and the Nilo-Saharan. But now you have a South Sudan. You had Chad. We know Chad, the demographic of Chad. We know that the predominant population of Chad is Nilo-Saharan. We know that the dominant population in the country, African nation of Niger, is Afro-Asiatic. And these nations, these countries, they have embassies in countries around the world. Now, pay attention to the fact that you have other African nations. Do you see these nations have embassies in other African nations? Do you see the South Sudan being able to have an embassy in other African nations? There are Niger, Congo. Do you see the Niger Congo trying to build an embassy in South Sudan, in North Sudan? The Niger Congo countries and the Niger Congo, where the Niger Congo are the predominant population, like Kenya, for instance, they do have a minority of Nilo-Saharan. Uganda, I think Tanzania too, in the Great Lakes area. And they also have a population of the Khoi people and the San people. See, this is a very serious issue because today, in current events, the United States government has reopened the embassy in Cuba. There was an embargo, not only an embargo, but the embargo was put in place for other countries. Other nations couldn't even deal with Cuba. This is what that meant. Cuba was isolated from the rest of the world. Now you have a South Sudan. This is a very serious issue. Why? Since President Obama, his father, as you know, his father, the Nilo-Saharan, Luo. His mother was a Jewish, European, white lady. And while he been in office, now you have a South Sudan. That's a recognized nation by the United Nations, by other nations. Now you have a South Sudan. And now, since he's still in the office, United States government no longer has an embargo with Cuba. They reopened the embassy in Cuba. And you see who lives in Cuba. The Cubans. That's who live in Cuba. Who are the Cubans? The Europeans. And who else? The Niger Congo slaves that came over on a slave ship. That's who in Cuba. So now you have a South Sudan. What are you implying? I'm not implying anything. I'm just going to let you sit here and figure it out yourself. I'm going to let you sit there and think about it yourself. You have a South Sudan now. And now the United States government has reopened the embassy in Cuba. So somebody looking for some influence somewhere, where would you look? They looking for somebody to listen to them and to you know, listen to him. And see if somebody sitting up in the White House. We see a South Sudan. See, this is a very serious issue. See, he wouldn't be in the White House if it hadn't been with him saying he was black, colored, Negro, African American. Because, you know, like he said, he'll win a third term. Well, I knew what you were saying. I knew exactly what you were saying. That's how I got in the White House the first time and the second time. So if I ran a third time, I just go out there and do it again. Just, I'm black. I'm colored. I'm Negro. I'm just like you. He had not no hair. You're not just like me. And that's what makes it dangerous. See, you don't understand the agenda of the Nilo Sahara. That's really why it's so important for the from the Niger Congo to make it perfectly clear that when you hear a person say they're Nilo Sahara, or when you hear a person say they're Afro-Asiatic, you hear a person say they're Khoi, they're saying, they're not just saying that for just to be saying. They have their own way of life. They have their own viewpoint. They have their own philosophy. They have their own way of life that is contrary to the Niger Congo. That is different from the Niger Congo. That is opposite of the Niger Congo. You don't never assume anything. See, that's what gets people in trouble every time. You assume. That's what you should not do. You should be sure. You should be certain. You see, that's one thing that the President of the United States, Barack Hussein Obama, can't do. You can assume that you will win a third term. But that's what it is. That's an assumption. Based on the fact, black, colored, Negro, African American, skin color. You understand? Based on that. But that's an assumption. But today, like we say, we have current events, and that's an assumption that we should never make about Cuba being used by the South Sudanese for influence. Because being that they draw that border, now this country is in existence. They're looking for influence. Any way they can find on this planet. And when they know there's a Nilo Sahara in the White House. And this does not exclude the North Sudanese. Because see, the North Sudanese has always been. Khartoum has always been the North. They've always been there. You know, understand what I mean? They've been there. There was no border drawn for South Sudan or North Sudan, it was Sudan. And since the North was the predominant population, they was in control. But now you have two You had Afro-Asiatics in the north, and you had a predominant population in the south, which is the Nilo-Saharan. There is a population of Niger Congo in the South Sudan, a minority. But we should not make an assumption that Cuba is not being looked at by the South Sudanese, because they know that the president is a Nilo-Saharan in the White House, and during his administration, South Sudan became a nation. While he was the president now, while he's still in office, the U.S. Embassy has now reopened in Cuba. And with him being in the White House, what do you think he's going to do? Being that he's the president, and when he see those blacks, you know what he'll do? He'll try the same thing. He'll try to go amongst the blacks in Cuba, the Niger Congo, and he'll say he black, he colored, he Negro, he African-American. He won't say he a Nilo-Saharan. He'll just say he black, he colored, he Negro, he African-American. And when the Niger Congo on the continent of Africa see him, they know who they see. And that's what you should see. Because that's who your ancestors are. That's who you are today. You don't have to stop saying, you don't have to deny your ancestors, because it's your ancestors 10 generations. That's something you should be proud of. No matter how many generations there. Never assume that the person that's in the White House don't have an agenda. And that agenda, you assume that that agenda is to help you, being that you are in the Western Hemisphere, me, myself, and my family, and everybody in this neighborhood, everybody in this city, state, everybody in this county, everybody in this country, everybody in this Western Hemisphere, whose ancestor, Niger Congo, don't never assume that President Barack Hussein Obama's agenda is to help you. He a Nilo-Saharan. See, that's how the South Sudan became a nation, while he was in office. They've been fighting for decades. They've been over there fighting in the Sudan. But while he was in office, the fighting ceased. But the North Sudan, they still call themselves trying to bomb the South Sudan. You know, you try to disguise your trickery. But it's not a secret that the Afro-Asiatic and the Nilo-Saharan work together. You don't have to take my word for it. You know, like it's just be running off at the mouth. There are people who will verify, they'll show you proof that the Afro-Asiatic and the Nilo-Saharan be working together against the Niger Congo. Against the Niger Congo. That's what they be doing. So when you see the North Sudanese and now you see a South Sudan, we see that the embassy in Cuba is open. So, what assumption are you making? Because that's not the assumption I'm making. See, this is a very serious issue. This should not be taken lightly. That there's a South Sudan. That's one of the most serious issues of today. Because from this day forward, they're going to have, as you call it, a nation, a country that's recognized by the United Nations. And that's a very serious issue. And now you have a border, so that means they have to have a defense to defend that border. Just like the North Sudanese. They have a military that will defend their border. And then when it comes to dealing with the United Nations, other nations around the world, see, this is what South Sudan will do. They'll have relations with other nations that are not on the African continent, in Europe, the Middle East, South Asia, East Asia. Then get over into the Western Hemisphere. See, this is really why it's so serious when you have a South Sudan and then you look over in the Western Hemisphere. North America, South Central America, South America, and the Caribbean, and the Pacific Islands. I know you here in the West Area, you want black, colored, Negro, African American, whatever. But still, you know, that's an assumption. See, you're assuming. See, that's an assumption that you're making. See, that's really why my previous video, not last week, but the week before, I apologize. I apologize because I made a mistake. It's my mistake. I made a mistake with that black, colored, Negro, African American. I made a mistake. And it's a mistake that should not be made. Shouldn't make that mistake. Shouldn't make that assumption. Very serious issue when you get to here in this Western Hemisphere. You see a South Sudan, you see a North Sudan. See, sometimes people can say one thing in one place, then they'll go somewhere else and say something different than what the North Sudanese and the South Sudanese will do. See, one place they'll say one thing on the continent of Africa, they'll say North Sudan, South Sudan, that the North Sudanese are bombing the South Sudan. Then when they go somewhere else, they go to Europe somewhere, they go to East Asia somewhere, or they end up over here in the Western Hemisphere with their embassy and their consulates. And then they'll say something different. That's a very serious issue. It's a very serious topic. Because that's how many people have been victimized, is through influence. not just a physical victimization, but it's been something that's been said previously that people will intentionally teach you the wrong thing, or they'll intentionally misinform you. That's the point that we get into, is the intentional misinformation. See, that's the assumption you should not make. Assuming that a person that black, colored, Negro, African American, that you can't be misinformed when you sit down on Sahara or Afro-Asiatic. First of all, you don't even speak the same language. You sitting there asking them what that mean when you said what that mean. If you gotta ask somebody what it mean, what you said or what you know what you did, then that's what it mean. You got to ask them what that mean, and they'll tell you anything. And that's what we don't want to happen. See, their intention say they do the thing they do as a way to defend themselves, to protect themselves. Then what you gonna do to defend yourself, protect yourself from the Nile Sahara, from the Afro-Asiatic? Because the court people and the sand people, they almost extinct. That's the truth today. They almost extinct. That's true. Look, do your own research. Do your own research on the court people and the sand people, and you will see they almost extinct. They're on the verge of being extinct. Go too much longer. But on today's video, that's what we're going to continue to talk about: African traditional religion. Because this is your way of life. This is serious issues. This is not something that should be played with or taken lightly. It's a very serious issue. And we're gonna pick up on this subject on the next time. I'm gonna end today's video. And again, my name is Eric D. Johnson, also known as Bright Shine. I live right here in the city of Memphis. It's in the state of Tennessee, it's in the county of Shelby. And thank all my fans and my support for every team, encouragement and support. Till my next video, take care of yourself, and I wish each and every one of you the very best.